Hey guys, welcome back to the data science course. And in today's session, we'll look at different methods to evaluate a model's performance. So we'll start off by learning how can we find the right threshold for a model. Then we'll build an ROC curve. And finally, we'll learn how to get the area under the curve. So let's get started. Now in the previous sessions, we gave some arbitrary values for the threshold, but obviously it is not the right way. And to get the best accuracy, we need to get that perfect threshold value. So we need to plot a graph of accuracy versus cutoff so that we can get that right threshold. So there's a package called as ROCR in R which helps us to get this threshold value. Now accuracy is not the only criteria. There also should be a right trade-off between the true positive rate and the false positive rate. So the best cutoff has the highest true positive rate together with the lowest false positive rate. And to get the right balance with respect to true positive rate and false positive rate, we can build an ROC curve. So the term ROC stands for receiver operating characteristic, and it helps in getting the performance of a model with respect to all classification thresholds. Then we have AUC. So AUC measures the entire two-dimensional area underneath the entire ROC curve. So it's an aggregate measure of performance across all possible classification thresholds. And it ranges in value from 0 to 1. So a model whose predictions are 100% wrong has an AUC of 0, and a model whose predictions are 100% correct has an AUC of 1. So let's go to RStudio and work with these. We have RStudio right in front of us, and this is our same old customer churn dataset. And before we go ahead with the performance metrics, let's actually build a model. So I'll load the CA tools package. Now with the help of sample.split function, I'll divide the dataset, and I'll be dividing it with respect to the churn column. And the split ratio which I'll give is 0.65. Okay. So I'll store this in an object called as split tag. Now with the help of subset function, let me split it. So I'll give the first parameter, which is the dataset. Now from the entire data set, wherever the value of split tag is equal to true, I'll store all of these observations in the training set. Similarly, from the entire customer churn data set, wherever the value of split tag is equal to false, I'll select all those observations and store them in the test set. So we have our training and testing sets ready. Now it's time to build the model on top of the training set. So I'll use the JLM function and I'll give the formula first. So this time I'd want to understand how does churn vary with respect to the monthly charges cost. That is, churn would be the dependent variable and monthly charges would be the independent variable. So I've given the formula. Next is the data set, which would be train. After the data set, I need to give the family of regression, which would be binomial over here. And I will store this in an object called as mod log. So I built the model. Now it's time to predict the values. So I'll use predict function. The first parameter is the model which you just built. So it'll be mod log. Then we need to give the new data, which would be test. And after giving the new data set, I would need to give the type of the prediction. So the type of the prediction over here would be response. And I will store this in an object called as result log. Let me have a glance at the predicted values. So it'll be view of result log. So guys, these are all of the predicted probabilities. Okay. Right. Now let me just build a random confusion matrix over here. Okay. So I'll type table. Let me include the actual values for test, dollar churn. Let me give the predicted values, which are there in result log. So let me give an arbitrary threshold value of 0.1. So this is what we get over here. Okay, right. But then again, we can't just use any random threshold value. Okay, so this is where the performance metrics comes in. And we can use the performance metrics with the help of the ROCR package. So let me load the ROCR package first. Library of ROCR. Keep in mind that all of these are in capitals. Okay, ROCR is in capitals. So I have loaded the ROCR package, right? Now after loading the package, this package gives us two very important functions, which are prediction and performance. Now let me show you guys how it's done. I'll type prediction. This takes in two parameters. First is all of the predicted values. Next is all of the labels of the original values. Okay. So let me give the predicted values over here, which are there in result log. Let me give the labels from the original set, which are there in test dollar churn. Now I'll store this in a new object and I'll name it to be, let's say, red log. Okay, so this is a new prediction type object. Now I will use performance function. Now this function helps us to work with different performance metrics such as accuracy, ROC curve and area under the curve. So starting with, I'd like to get the maximum accuracy with this model. Okay, so again, this takes in two parameters over here. First is the prediction object which you've just built. So it is stored in red log. Now after this, we need to give the type of performance metric which you want. So I'd want to get the accuracy. So I'll type ACC over here and I will store this in an object called as ACC. Okay, now let me plot this. So plot of ACC, let's see what do we get. So guys, this is what we get over here, right? So this is basically a plot with respect to accuracy and the cutoff. That is, accuracy is on the y-axis and cutoff is on the x-axis. And this helps us to determine how does accuracy vary with respect to the cutoff. So what we see is the maximum accuracy is around 0.7. And threshold value for that would be around 0.41 or 0.42. Okay? Right. So now, what I'll do is I'll build a confusion matrix with respect to this threshold value so that I get the maximum accuracy. Okay, so let me do that. I'll type table. Let me give the actual values. Test dollar churn. Now it's time for predicted values, result log, and the threshold value is 0.41. okay, so guys, this is what we get over here. Now let me check the accuracy. So 1780 plus of 6 divided by 1780 plus 6 plus 31 plus 648. So you get an accuracy of 72%, right? So when we use the threshold value of 0.41, we get an accuracy of 72%. But then again, as I've told you guys, accuracy cannot be the only measure when we are trying to evaluate the performance of a model. We also have to look at the true positive rates and the false positive rates. So let's check the true positive rates first. Okay. So true positive rate can be found out by dividing all of the true positives with respect to the sum of true positives and false negatives. Okay, so it'll be 6 divided by 6 plus 648. Okay, so this is what we get. So the true positive rate is 0.0091. Now let me get the false positive rate over here. So false positive rate can be obtained by dividing all of the false positives with respect to the sum of false positives and true negatives. So it'll be 31 divided by 31 plus 1780. So the false positive rate is 0.017. Now the true positive rate is very low. The false positive rate is also low, but it is actually greater than the true positive rate, which cannot be the case, right? So that is why, even though the accuracy is good, the trade-off between true positive rate and false positive rate is very bad. So that is why we'll build an ROC curve to get a right trade-off between the true positive rate and the false positive rate. So again, I'll use the performance function. I'll give in the prediction object. So it'll be pred log. Since I want to build an ROC curve, I'll type TPR, which stands for true positive rate. Then I'll type FPR, which stands for false positive rate. Okay. And I will store this in, let's say, ROC curve. Now let me make a plot of this. Plot of ROC curve. So guys, this is what we get. So we get a graph with respect to true positive rate and false positive rate. That is, true positive rate is on the y-axis and false positive rate is on the x-axis. Okay. Now let me also give a color with respect to the cutoff. So I'll use the colorize parameter over here. And I will colorize it with respect to the cutoff. So I'll just type true over here. Right. So this color of this line which you see, so this color is basically being determined with the cutoff values over here. the cutoff values start from 0.15 and they go to 0.43. So now when we use a threshold value of 0.41, so over here, so the value is red, okay? So this is where the threshold value is 0.41. So over here, the true positive rate is very, very low and the false positive rate is very, very low. So that is why this is not the right trade-off between true positive rate and false positive rate. So let's take some point over here. So over here, true positive rate is very good and the false positive rate is moderate enough, okay? So now let's say this is green over here, right? So this ranges from 0.26 to 0.32. Now let's say the value which I'll take is 0.28, okay? So now I'll take a threshold value of 0.28 and build a confusion matrix with respect to that threshold value. Okay, table. So first I'll type test $chun, then the predicted values, result log, and the threshold value is 0.28. Now let me start off by checking the accuracy first. So it'll be 1066 plus 429 divided by 1066 plus 429 plus 225 plus 745. So this is what we get over here. So we get an accuracy of 60%. Now, even though this accuracy is not as good as that, let's also check the true positive rate and false positive rate. Then let's come to a conclusion. Okay. So let's start with a true positive rate first. So it'll be 429 divided by 429 plus 225. So we get a true positive rate of 0.65. So when we used the threshold value of 0.41, the true positive rate was very low. And when we use the threshold value of 0.28, the true positive rate is good enough. Okay. Now let's also check the false positive rate. So it'll be 745 divided by 745 plus 1066. So the false positive rate is 0.41, which is lower than the true positive rate. So this somehow seems to be an ideal trade-off between the true positive rate and the false positive rate. Okay. So that is why accuracy cannot be the only performance metric when we are evaluating the model. We also have to look at the true positive rate and the false positive rate. Okay. So this was the ROC curve. Then we'll work with the final performance metric, which will be the AUC, which is nothing but the area under the curve. And this area under the curve gives us an aggregate measure of performance across all possible classification thresholds. Okay. So again, I'll type performance over here. Let me give the prediction object. So it'll be red log. After this, I need to give the type of performance metric, which will be AUC. And I will store this in an object called as AUC. Now let me print this. So this Y name which you see, so this is the area under the ROC curve and this is the value for it. So the area under the ROC curve is 0.62. Now as I've already told you guys, if this value is closer to 1, then it'll be 100% perfect. And if it is closer to 0, then it'll be 100% wrong. So it's 0.62 and it's good enough. Okay. So these were the three performance metrics from the ROCR package. And guys, this brings us to the end of the session. Thanks for attending and let's meet in the next class. Thank you.